E4 is the most AD known outside of age. So when you talk about the power of genes, this is a very powerful gene. This was the early paper by Porter and Strittmeyer. I just thought you might like to see it. 1993. This is how long we've been using this this gene to think about Alzheimer's disease. So here are the homozygotes, two copies of E4. Here are the heterozygotes, one copy. Here are the non-carriers. So let's say age 75. So at age 75, 80% of your homozygotes have developed Alzheimer's disease. At age 75, 50% of your heterozygotes have developed Alzheimer's disease. At age 75, only 20% of your non-carriers have developed Alzheimer's disease. So it's, again, you just see this very powerful effect. And you can see that the E4 drives the age of onset down, and it drives the risk up. So again, if you have two carriers, if you have two copies of the gene, 90% chance of getting Alzheimer's disease. One copy, 46% in this early paper, 0 to 20%. So why is E4 a problem in Alzheimer's disease? Well, we know that amyloid beta protein is associated with AD, and both Michael and Marty have shown us that, and E3 enhances A-beta clearance. So E3, so if you have the E3, you're more likely to get Alzheimer's disease out of your brain. Right now, you're sitting there, you're making amyloid, okay? So if you're getting it out of your brain, you're less likely to get Alzheimer's disease. But if it's being trapped in your brain because you're an E4 carrier, then it's accumulating in plaques, and you can handle that while you're young, and you can't handle it while you're old, and you get Alzheimer's disease. So E4 is associated with greater A-beta accumulation. Let's just look at some recent data on this. These are very striking figures. You know, we can look now at amyloid in the brain with amyloid imaging. We do this every day at the Lou Ruvo Center. So we can look into your brain and see whether you have an amyloid group. So not very many people at age 45 to 59 have amyloid in the brain. But look how much higher it is in the E4 carriers versus the non-carriers. So none of the non-carriers have an amyloid in the brain. Whereas at this early age, already 11% of your carriers do. Age 60 to 69, now of your carriers, 36.7% have amyloid in the brain already, right? Compared to only 8% of your non-carriers. What about 7 to 79? 50% now have accumulated amyloid in the brain compared to 15% of your non-carriers. How about if you make it? If you make it all the way to age 80 to 89, 75% of people now have amyloid in the brain, measurable amyloid on amyloid. So there's a huge influence on amyloid accumulation of the presence of the E4 gene. And we think that's what's driving the Alzheimer's disease, of course. So what could we do? Could we use this as a therapeutic avenue? If this is so powerful, then is it a way to interrupt the disease? We think so. So there's a number of ways of thinking about this. You could convert the structure of E4 to look more like E3. That'd be cool. You could interrupt the E4-A-beta interaction. That might be important. You could lipidate E3 to enhance A-beta transport across the blood-brain barrier. And I'm going to show you that that's what we think we did. There's also a role for antisynthetic nucleotides in the future, but it's an extremely interesting genetic approach to therapeutics. So this observation was made in 2012 by Gary Vanger at Case Western Reserve University. And he found that EPOE-directed therapeutics rapidly clear A-beta and reverse deficits in AD mouse models. So he gave a drug, a cancer drug called bexarotene, to mice, and it reduced the amyloid burden by 50% in 7 days. 50% in 7 days. We've never seen a drug do anything like this before, remarkably. And it improved the performance in the Morris water course. As you can see here, here's the next group performing most closer to the wild type than to the untreated group. So we said, shouldn't we try that in humans? Right? It doesn't seem very profound, but we were the only group in the U.S. to decide that it should be tested in humans. And we had this drug available to us because it was already approved for cutaneous T-cell lymphoma. So it had, and this is a disease which occurs in the 70s, so there was already a huge amount of information about the exposure of older people to this drug. So we formulated the BEAT-AD trial, vaccine amyloid treatment for AD. We did the trial, and Jeff Kenny, who's going to follow me, sits right here, and tell you all about the biomarkers. It was based on this mouse study, Case Western. We randomized 20 people to Vex or placebo, a small study, but I said, well, if it has a large effect, we don't need a large study. In fact, you only need one patient if you cure the disease. Right? You only need one patient. So we think powerful drugs should be used. We did amyloid imaging at the beginning and at the end of the trial. That was our primary outcome. And the research question was, does vexatine decrease the toxic amyloid protein of AD? The answer is, no, it doesn't. Unless you analyze my genome. And that was a pre-specified primary outcome. So in the AD patients who did not have the AD4 gene, we showed a statistically significant reduction in brain A-beta. This is the only small molecule in the history of mankind ever to be shown in a double-blind placebo-controlled trial to do exactly this. And we think this is what we have. So it decreased amyloid, and as Jeff will show you, it increased serum amyloid. So we think that we can see both ends of this equation. It's going down in the brain, it's going up in the serum. They're highly correlated. The exposure was too brief to produce a clinical response. We gave it to them for a month. You know, my question was, can we get amyloid out of the brain? And we knew that if we wanted to produce a clinical response, it was probably going to take a year's therapy in a much larger group. So here's what we saw in the E4 non-carriers. Remember, I'm showing you only the non-carriers. So first of all, there was a statistically significant reduction in the composite, which is the whole amyloid level. And then it was statistically significant in 5 of 6 cortical regions. So I don't think that's a random result, right? Because it's so systematized. It happened in none of the placebo patients. It happened in all of the Bex patients. And it happened in 5 of 6 cortical regions. In theory, these brains turn around, but they're not turning today. So here's the vexatine. You can see we've labeled the amyloid here. You can see the removal of the amyloid after 4-week exposure. You can see that there was a slight increase in amyloid in the placebo group. And if you look at the composite of the AD of the vexatine and the placebo patients, you see the removal of amyloid fairly dramatically. So we think this is really exciting. Right? We're very excited about this. It's the first drug to reduce brain amyloid in a double-blind trial. By the way, there are several monoclonal antibodies who have done this. So I won't tell you that this is the only therapy that has ever done it, but it is the only small molecule to ever have done it. There are at least two monoclonals that have been shown to do this. There's no cognitive benefit seen, but in the monoclonal studies, for example, you don't see anything for the first 6 months. It's only for months 6 through 12 that you begin to see the cognitive benefit associated with decreased beta amyloid. So we think long therapy is going to be necessary. So here's the summary. E4 is a nasty gene. It's a risk factor for AD, and I haven't told you how it acts in many other diseases, but it has an adverse effect in multiple sclerosis and traumatic brain injury and many other disorders. Despite its very powerful effect in AD, it's surprising that APOE-based therapies have not been pursued. So this is actually one of the very first examples where we've used this hint and look to see whether we can manipulate it for a therapeutic benefit. We think it had a promise. We think we've seen a genotype-specific treatment response where the non-carriers responded and the carriers didn't. Now, that could possibly just be a duration of exposure effect, because we know the beta amyloid in the E4 carrier is much more compact. And so it may just be that we need to treat them longer in order to mobilize the A-beta in the carriers. We don't know whether this is a duration effect or could be a gene effect. And we think that this is an extremely provocative observation and one that needs to be followed up with a larger, longer trial to see whether we have something important here. Thanks.
Are you going to, or should I just go?
Do we have any questions for Dr. Cummings?
So, yeah, because I guess I wasn't clear. So was it only one patient who actually had that decrease in